newly discovered evidence inscribed on tablets from Nippur, one of the oldest and most sacred cities of Mesopotamia, has changed everything we think we know about the Middle East. These bizarre texts are written in Sumerian, the language spoken by the non-Semitic people whom the Semitic Mesopotamians conquered and displaced, and they include a very primitive version of the deluge story and creation myth, and some texts which throw new light on the age of Mesopotamian civilization and on the area within which it had its rise. In them, we have recovered some of the material from which Berossus derived his dynasty of antediluvian kings, and we are thus enabled to test the accuracy of the Greek traditions by that of the Sumerians themselves. So far then, as Mesopotamia is concerned, these documents will necessitate a re-examination of more than one problem. The myths and legends of ancient Egypt are also to some extent involved. The trend of much recent anthropological research has been in the direction of seeking a single place of origin for similar beliefs and practices, at least among people who are bound to one another by political or commercial ties. Furthermore, we shall have occasion to test, utilizing our new data, a recent theory of Egyptian influence. The Nile Valley was, of course, one of the great centers from which civilization radiated throughout the ancient East, and even when direct contact is unproved, Egyptian literature may furnish instructive parallels and contrasts in which any study of Western Asiatic mythology. Moreover, by a strange coincidence, there has also been published in Egypt, since the beginning of the war, a record referring to the reigns of pre-dynastic rulers in the Nile Valley. This, like some of the Nippur texts, take us back to that indefinite period before the dawn of actual history, and through the information it affords is not detailed like theirs. It provides fresh confirmation of the general accuracy of Mantheo's sources and suggests some interesting points for comparison. However, the people with those traditions we are ultimately concerned are the Hebrews. Dr. Cannon Driver showed how the literature of Assyria and Mesopotamia had thrown light upon Hebrew traditions concerning the origin and early history of the world. Most of the cuneiform documents on which he based his comparison date from a period no earlier than the 7th century BC, and yet it was clear that the texts themselves, in some form or other, must have descended from remote antiquity. He concluded his brief reference to the creation and deluge tablets with these words: "The Mesopotamian narratives are both polytheistic, while the corresponding biblical narratives, Genesis 1 and 6 through 11, are made the vehicle of a pure and exalted monotheism. But in spite of this fundamental difference, and also variations in details, the resemblance are such as to leave no doubt that the Hebrew cosmogony and the Hebrew story of the deluge are both derived ultimately from the same original as the Mesopotamian narratives, only transformed by the magic touch of Israel's religion and infused by it with a new spirit." Among the recently published documents from Nippur, we have recorded one at least of those primitive originals from which the Mesopotamian accounts were derived, while others prove the existence of variant stories of the world's origin and early history which have not survived in the later cuneiform texts. In some of these early Sumerian records, we have a faint but remarkable parallel with the Hebrew traditions of man's history between his creation and the flood. Our task is to examine the relations and the Hebrew narratives bear to the early Sumerian and later Mesopotamian versions and ascertain how far the discoveries support or modify current views concerning the contents of those early chapters of Genesis. I need not remind you that Genesis is the book of Hebrew origins and that its contents mark it off to some extent from the other books of the Hebrew Bible. The Pentateuch and the book of Joshua's objectives are described in their origin, the fundamental institutions of the national faith, and to the peoples from the earliest times, the course of events that led to the Hebrew settlement in Palestine. Of this national history, the book of Genesis forms the introductory section. 4 centuries of complete silence lie between its close and the beginning of Exodus, where we enter the history of a nation as contrasted with that of a family. While Exodus and succeeding books contain national traditions, Genesis is primarily made up of individual biography. We are primarily concerned with the Hebrew people's immediate ancestors, beginning with Abraham's migration into Canaan and closing with Joseph's death in Egypt. Nevertheless, the name of the book is not confined to recounting the ancestry of Israel. It also seeks to show her relation to other peoples in the world and probing still deeper into the past, and it describes how the earth itself was prepared for man's habitation. Thus, the patriarchal biographies are preceded by an account of the origin of the world, the beginnings of civilization, and the distribution of the various peoples of humanity. It is, of course, with certain parts of this first group of chapters that such striking parallels have long been recognized in the cuneiform texts. In approaching this body of Hebrew traditions, the necessities for some caution will be apparent. It is not as though we were dealing with a Malayan or Central Australian tribe's reported beliefs. In such a case, there will be no difficulty in applying a purely objective criticism without regard to ulterior consequences. Nevertheless, here our feelings are involved, having their roots deep in early associations. The ground too is well trodden, and had there been no new material to discuss, I think I should have preferred a less contentious theme. The new material is my justification for the choice of subject, and the fact that whatever views we may hold, it will be necessary for us to assimilate to them. I shall have no hesitation in giving my readings of the evidence, but at the same time, it will be possible to indicate solutions that will probably appeal to those who view the subject from more conservative standpoints. That side of the discussion may well be postponed until after examining the new evidence in detail. Moreover, it would be advisable to clear up some general aspects of the problem and define the limits of our criticism. It must be admitted that both Egypt and Mesopotamia bear a terrible name in Hebrew tradition. Both are synonymous with captivity, the symbols of suffering endured at the beginning and the close of the national life. Furthermore, during the struggle against Assyrian aggression, the disappointment at the failure of expected help is reflected in prophecies of the period. These great crises in Hebrew history have tended to obscure in the national memory the part which both Mesopotamia and Egypt may have played in molding the civilization of the smaller nations with whom they come in contact. To such influence, the peoples of Syria were, by geographical position, peculiarly subject. The country has often been compared to a bridge between the two great continents of Asia and Africa, flanked by the sea on one side and the desert on the other, a narrow causeway of highland and coastal plain connecting the valleys of the Nile and the Euphrates. For the frontier of Egypt, desert and sea do not meet. Farther north, the Arabian Plateau is separated from the Mediterranean by a double mountain chain, which runs south of the Taurus, at varying elevations, and closes its lower course the Great Depression of the Jordan Valley, the Dead Sea, and the Arabah. The Judean hills and the mountains of Moab are merely the southward prolongations of the Lebanon and anti-Lebanon, and their neighborhood to the sea endows this narrow tract of habitable country with its moisture and fertility. It thus formed the natural channel of intercourse between the two earliest centuries of civilization and was later the battleground of their opposing empires. Through communication, the Greek trunk roads run north and south, across the eastern plateaus of the Haran and Moab, and along the coastal plains. The old highway from Egypt, which left the delta at Pelusium, at first follows the coast, then trends eastward across the plain of Esdraelon, which breaks the coastal range, and passing under Hermans, runs northward through Damascus and reaches the Euphrates at its most westerly point. Other through tracks in Palestine ran then, as they do today, by Beersheba and Hebron, or along the Abra and west of the Dead Sea, or through Edom and east of Jordan by the present Hajru, Damascus. However, the great highway from Egypt, the most westerly of the trunk roads through Palestine, was that mainly followed, with some variant sections, by both caravans and armies, and was known by the Hebrews in its south course as the Way of the Philistines, and further north as the Way of the East. The plan of Israelon, where the road first trends eastward, has been the battlegrounds for most invaders of Palestine from the north and through Egyptian armies often fought in the southern coastal plains. They too had battled there, where they held the southern country. Megiddo, which commands the main pass into the plain through the low Samaritan hills to the southeast of Carmel, was the site of Thothmoses III's famous battle against Assyrian Confederation, and it inspired the writer of the Apocalypse with the vision of an Armageddon of the future. However, invading armies always followed the beaten track of caravans, and movements represented by the great campaigns were reflected in the daily passages of international commerce. With so much through traffic continually passing within her borders, it may be a matter for surprise that far more striking evidence of its cultural effect should not have been revealed by archaeological research in Palestine. Here again, the explanation is mainly geographical. The trunk roads could cross the plains and plateaus. The rest of the country is so broken up by mountains and valleys that it presented few facilities to foreign penetration or external control. The physical barrier to local intercourse, reinforced by striking differences in soil, altitude, and climate, while they preclude Syria herself from attaining national unity, always tended to protect her separate provinces or kingdoms from the full effects of foreign aggression. One city-state could be traversed, devastated, or annexed without, in the minor degree, affecting neighboring areas. Indeed, Syria's population has always been predominantly Semitic, for she was on the fringe of the excellent breeding ground of the Semitic peoples, and her landward boundaries was open to the Arabian nomad. Indeed, in the whole course of her history, the only peoples that bade fair at one time to oust the Semite in Syria were Greek. Nevertheless, the Greeks remained within the city which they founded or rebuilt, and, as Robert Smith pointed out, the death rate in eastern cities habitually exceeds the birth rate. The urban population must be reinforced from the country if it is to be maintained, so that the blood of the peasantry ultimately determines the type of population. Hence, after the Arab conquest, the Greek elements in Syria and Palestine tended rapidly to disappear. The Muslim invasion was only the last of a series of similar significant inroads, which have followed one another since the dawn of history and during all that time. Absorption was continually taking place from desert tribes that ranged the Syrian border. As we have seen, his adoption was to encourage the Semitic nomad's particularism, which was inherent in his tribal organization. Thus, the predominance of a single racial element in Palestine and Syria did little to break down or overstep the natural barriers and lines of cleavage. These facts suffice to show why Egypt and Mesopotamia's influence upon the various peoples and kingdoms of Palestine was only intensified at specific periods when abomination for a vast empire dictated the reduction of her provinces in detail. However, in the long intervals, during which there were no attempt to enforce political control, normal relations were maintained along the lines of trade and barter. Furthermore, in any estimate of the possible effect of foreign influence upon Hebrew thought, it is essential to realize that some of the channels through which in later periods it may have acted had been flowing since the dawn of history, and even perhaps in prehistoric times. Syria probably formed one of the links by which we may explain the Mesopotamian elements attested in prehistoric Egyptian culture. However, another possible line of advance may have been by way of Arabia and across the Red Sea into Upper Egypt. The last line of contact is suggested by an interesting piece of evidence that has recently been obtained. A prehistoric flint knife with a handle carved from the tooth of a hippopotamus has been purchased lately by the Louvier and is said to have been found at Gibel el Arak near Naga Hammadi, which lies on the Nile not far below Koptos, where an ancient caravan track leads by Wadi Hammamat to the Red Sea. On one side of the handle is a battle scene, including some excellent representations of ancient boats. All the warriors are nude, except a loin girdle, but while one set of combatants have shaved heads or short hair, The others have great locks falling in a thick mass upon the shoulder. On the other face of the handle is carved a hunting scene, two hunters with dog and desert animals being arranged around a central boss. Nevertheless, the upper field is a very remarkable group, consisting of a personage struggling with two lions arranged symmetrically. The rest of the composition is not very unlike other examples of prehistoric Egyptian carving in low relief, but her attitude, figure, and clothing are un-Egyptian. The hero wears a turban on his abundant hair, and a complete and rounded beard descends upon his breast. A long garment clothes him from the waist and falls below the knee, his muscular calves ending in the claws of a bird of prey. There is nothing like this in prehistoric Egyptian art. Perhaps Monsieur Benedict is pressing his theme too far when he compares the close-cropped warriors on the handle with the shaven Sumerians and Elamites upon steels from Tello and Susa, for their loin girdles are African and entirely foreign to the Euphrates Valley. Moreover, his suggestion that two of the boats, flat-bottom and with high curved ends, seem only to have navigated the Tigris and Euphrates, will hardly command acceptance. Nevertheless, there is no doubt that the heroic personage upon the other face is represented in the friendly attitude of the Mesopotamian hero Gilgamesh, struggling with lions, which formed so favorite subject upon early Sumerian and Mesopotamian seals. His garment is Sumerian or Semitic rather than Egyptian, and the mixture of human and bird elements in the figure, though not precisely paralleled at this early period, is not out of harmony with Mesopotamian or Susan tradition. His beard is quite different from that of the Libyan desert tribes that early Egyptian kings adopted. Though the treatment of the lions is suggestive of Proto-Elamite rather than of early Mesopotamian models, the design itself is unmistakable of Mesopotamian origin. This discovery intensifies the significance of other early parallels that have been noted between the civilizations of the Euphrates and the Nile. But its evidence, so far as it goes, does not point to Syria as the medium of prehistoric intercourse. However then, as later, there can have been no physical barrier to the use of the river route from Mesopotamia into Syria, and of the tracks thence southward along the land bridge to the Nile's delta. In the early historical periods, we have definite evidence that the eastern coast of the Levant exercised an intense fascination upon the rulers of both Egypt and Mesopotamia. It may be admitted that Syria had little to give compared to what she could borrow, but her local trade in wine and oil must have benefited by an increase in the through traffic which followed the working of copper in Sirius and Sinai silver in the Taurus. Moreover, in the cedar forests of Lebanon and the north, she possessed a highly valued product in Egypt and the treeless plains of Mesopotamia. The cedars procured by Siniferu from Lebanon at the close of the Third Dynasty were doubtless floated as rafts down the coast, and we may see in them evidence regular traffic in timber. It has long been known that the early Mesopotamian king, Sharrukin, or Sargon of Akkad, had pressed up the Euphrates to the Mediterranean, and we now have information that he too was fired by a desire for precious wood and metal. One of the recently published Nippur inscriptions contains copies of several his texts, collected by an ancient scribe from his statutes at Nippur, and from these, we gather additional details of his campaigns. We learn that after his complete subjugation of southern Mesopotamia, he turned his attention to the west and that Enlil gave him the lands from the upper sea to the lower sea, for example, from the Mediterranean to the Persian Gulf. Fortunately, this rather vague phrase, which survived in a later tradition, is restated in greater detail in one of the contemporary versions, which records that Enlil gave him the upper land, Mari, Larmuti, and Ibla, as far as the Cedar Forest and Silver Mountains. Mari was a city on the middle Euphrates, but the name may signify Mari's district, which lays in the upper course of Sargon's march. Now we know that the later Sumerian monarch, Gudea, obtained his cedar beams from the Amanus Range, which he names Amanum, and describes as the Cedar Mountains. Doubtless, he felled his trees on the eastern slopes of the mountain. Nevertheless, we may infer from his text that Sargon reached the coast and his cedar forest may have lain further to the south, perhaps as far south as Lebanon. The Silver Mountains can only be identified with the Taurus, where silver mines were worked in antiquity. The reference to Larmuti is interesting. for it's the same place as Larimuta or Larimuta, which we find mentioned in the Tel el Amarna letters. From the reference to this district in the letters of Rib Adah, governor of Byblos, we may infer that it was a level district on the coast, capable of producing a considerable quantity of grain for export, was under Egyptian control at the time of Amenophis IV. Its position has been conjecturally placed in the Nile Delta, but we must probably seek it in the North Syrian or possibly the Sicilian coast from Sargon's reference. Perhaps as Dr. Fobel suggests, it was the plain of Antioch along the lower course and at the mouth of Orontes. However, his further suggestion that Sargon uses the term for the whole stretch of country between the sea and the Euphrates is hardly probable. The geographical reference need not be treated as exhaustive, but as confined to the more critical districts through which the expedition passed. The district of Ibla, which Naram-Sin and Gudea also mention, lay probably to the north of Larmuti, perhaps on the southern slopes of Taurus. It too, we may regard it as a district of limited extent, rather than as a general geographical term for the extreme north of Syria. Significantly, Sargon does not allude to any battle when describing this expedition, nor does he claim to have devastated the western countries. Indeed, most of these early expeditions to the west appear to have been inspired by motives of the commercial enterprise rather than of conquest. Nevertheless, the increase of wealth was naturally followed by political expansion, and pharaohs of the 18th dynasty realized Egypt's dream of the Asiatic Empire. The fact that Mesopotamian should have been adopted by the medium of official intercourse in Syria points to the closeness of the commercial ties which had already united the Euphrates Valley with the West. Egyptian control had passed from Canaan at the time of the Hebrew settlement, which was indeed a comparatively late episode in the early history of Syria. Whether or not we identify the Kabiri with the Hebrews, the latter's incursion's character is strikingly illustrated by some of the Tel el Amarna letters. We see nomad folk pressing in upon settled peoples and gaining a foothold here and there. The significant change from desert life consists in the adoption of agriculture, and when once that was made by the Hebrews, any further advance in economic development was dictated by the new surroundings. The exact process had been going on, as we have seen, in Syria since the dawn of history. The Semitic nomad passing gradually through the stages of agriculture and village life into that of the city. The country favored the retention of tribal exclusiveness, but ultimate survival could only be purchased at the cost of some amalgamation with their new neighbors. Below the surface of Hebrew history, these two tendencies may be traced in varying actions and reactions. Some sections of the peoples engaged readily in the social and commercial life of Canaanite civilization with its rich inheritance from the past. Others, especially in the highland of Judah and the south, succeeded in keeping themselves remote from foreign influence. During the later periods of the national life, the country was again subjected, and to an intensified degree, to those forces of political aggression from Mesopotamia and Egypt, which we have already noted as operating in Canaan. However, throughout the settled Hebrew community, the spark of desert fire was not extinguished, and by kindling the zeal of the prophets, it eventually affected nearly all the white peoples of humanity. In his early presidential address before the British Association at Newcastle, Sir Arthur Evans emphasized the part which recent archaeology has played in proving the continuity of human culture from the most remote periods. He showed how gaps in our knowledge had been abridged, and he traced the part which great people had taken in increasing its inheritance. We have, in fact, ample grounds for assuming an interchange, not only of commercial products, but in a minor degree, of ideas within areas geographically connected. And it is undoubtedly not derogatory to any Hebrew writer to suggest that he may have adopted and used for his purposes conceptions current among his contemporaries. In other words, the vehicle of religious ideas may well be of composite origin, and during our study of early Hebrew tradition, I suggest that we hold ourselves justified in applying the comparative method to some, at any rate, of the ingredients which went to form the finished product. The process is purely literary, but it finds an analogy in the study of Semitic art, especially in the later periods. Furthermore, I think it will make many meaning clearer if we consider a few examples of sculptures produced by people of Semitic origin. I do not suggest that we should regard the one process as in any way provide the existence of the other. We should instead treat the comparison as illustrating in another medium the effect of forces which it is clear were operative at various periods upon people of the same stock from which the Hebrews themselves were descended. In such material products, the eye at once detects the Semite's readiness to avail himself of foreign models. In some cases, direct borrowing is pronounced. In others, to adapt a metaphor from music. It is possible to trace extenuous motives in the design. Some of the most famous monuments of Semitic art date from the Persian and Hellenistic periods, and if we glance at them in this connection, it is to illustrate during its most obvious phase, a tendency of which the earlier effects are less pronounced. In the sarcophagus of the Sidonian king, Ishmuazar II, which is preserved in the Louvre, we have indeed a monument to which no Semitic sculptor can lay claim. Artistry and material are Egyptian, and there is no doubt that it was sculpted in Egypt and transported to Sidon by sea. Nevertheless, the king's engravers added the long Phoenician inscription, in which he adjures princes and men not to open his resting place, since there are no jewels therein, concluding with some potent curses against any violation of his tomb. One of the latter implores the holy God to deliver such violators up to a mighty prince who shall rule over them, and was probably suggested by Alexander's recent occupation of Sidon in 332 BC. After his reduction and drastic punishment of Tyre, King Ishmuzar was not unique in his choice of burial in an Egyptian coffin, for he merely followed the examples of his royal father, Tebnith, priest of Ashtart and king of the Sidonians, whose sarcophagus, preserved at Constantinople, still bears addition to his epitaph, that of its former occupant, a certain Egyptian general, Peneptah. However, more instructive than these borrowed memorials is a simple example of Phoenician work, the stele set up by Yiwa Milk, king of Byblos, and dating from the 4th or 5th century BC. In the sculptured panel at the head of the stele, the king is represented in the Persian dress of the period, standing in the presence of Ashtart or Astarte, his lady, mistress of Byblos. There's no doubt that the stele is of native artistry, but the influence of Egypt may be seen in the technique of the carving, in the winged disc above the figures, and still more in the representation of the goddess in her character as the Egyptian Hathor, which disc and horns, vulture headdress, and papyrus scepter. The inscription records the dedication of an altar and shrine to the goddess, and these two, we may conjecture, were fashioned on Egyptian lines. The representation of Semitic deities under Egyptian forms and Egyptian attributes was encouraged by introducing their cults into Egypt. In addition to Astarte of Byblos, Baal, Anath, and Reshef were all borrowed from Syria in comparatively early times and given Egyptian characters. The conical Syrian helmet of Reshef, a god of war and thunder, gradually gave place to the white Egyptian crown, so that as Rishpu, he was represented as a royal warrior, and Kadesh, another form of Astarte, became popular with Egyptian women as a patroness of love and fecundity, was also sometimes modeled on Hathor. Semitic colonists on the Egyptian border were ever ready to adopt Egyptian symbolism in delineating the native gods to whom they owed allegiance. And a particularly striking example of this may be seen on a stele of the Persian period, preserved in the Cairo Museum. It was found at Tel Defena, on the right bank of the Pelusiac branch of the Nile, close to the old Egyptian highway into Syria, a site that may be identified with the biblical Tampines and the Daphne of the Greeks. Here, it was that the Jewish fugitives, fleeing with Jeremiah after the fall of Jerusalem, founded a Jewish colony beside a flourishing Phoenician and Armenian settlement. One of the local gods of Tafpanese is represented on the Cairo monument in the form of a naos, with the winged solar disk upon its frieze. He stands on the back of a lion and clothed in Asiatic costume with the high Syria tiara, crowning his abundant hair. The Syrian artistry is evident, and the Syrian character of the cult may be recognized in such details as the small brazen fire altar before the god and the sacred pillar which the officiating priest is anointing. Nevertheless, the god holds in his left hand a purely Egyptian scepter and in his right hand an emblem as purely Mesopotamian, the weapon of Marduk and Gilgamesh, which early Sumerian kings also wielded.